Although I love the idea that the fewer ingredients you start with, the faster dinner gets on the table, that concept is just murder for me. I don't do well with a few ingredients. However, I gave it a shot. I started with 5 ingredients, and guess what? I came up with a trio of delicious dinners. Like salmon with hot mustard cracker topping, an easy way to wake up one of my favorite fish. And Jean Anderson's oven fried chicken, my all-time favorite fried chicken recipe, and it's not even fried. Served with 2 easy sides, braised mustard greens, and creamed corn. And just as we promised, they have less than 5 ingredients. So that's my experiment, and here's what I learned. Taste-wise, less is more. And time-wise, less is always better. Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.
Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Sara Moulton. Welcome to Sara's Weeknight Meals. You know, the husband and I have taken to eating rice crackers as a way to keep us from gnawing on our hands until dinner. As a matter of fact, it was the husband's idea to use these crackers in this dish I'm just about to do. Roasted salmon with hot mustard cracker topping. Now, these crackers come in many different flavors, and for this particular recipe, I like the wasabi. One really cool thing to know about them is 16 crackers. 16, count them, 16 is only 110 calories. So I know that one whole row is about 16, so there's 16, 32, and a few more. There you go. I'm just gonna crack them up with this rolling pin. You could do it with your hands, you know. All right, so that's ingredient number one. Let me get my salmon and my sour cream. And we'll make the glue. All right, so we have sour cream, about 1/3 cup here. And then we're gonna use English mustard. And what makes it different is it's hotter. You know, the Chinese mustard is made from the same mustard seeds, which are a mix of the yellow and the brown. Yellow mustard seeds are what goes into ballpark. We need 1.5 teaspoons of this here. And you know how ballpark mustard is sort of bland? That's because they just use the yellow mustard. And then to balance all of that, we only just need 1/2 teaspoon of brown sugar. Hot stuff and sugar do a happy dance. They just balance each other. So if you find that you've got something that's too spicy, add a little bit of sugar and it will make it seem less spicy without making it seem sweet. By the way, did I mention I'm going to make 4 recipes today and I can do it all in this amount of time because they're that easy when you start with 5 ingredients. Now, it's a good idea to check. There's so many websites where you can check about where you can find sustainable salmon, because not all salmon is raised in a good way or fished in a good way. In general, I try to get wild salmon when it's in season, but it's not in season every day of the year. But there are some farmed, sustainable forms of salmon that you can get. Just do your homework, go on the website, find out if it's good for the environment. Okay, how do you skin a fish? You get your knife underneath it. You need a little towel to cling on. And this is a 20-degree angle. I'm gonna just get started. And then after I get started, I'm just gonna pull the skin, not the knife. And why I like to do this is just it's nice to get the fish with the skin on, and then, you know, it's just fresher, and then you can do this. Also, it's sort of fun. When I used to work in restaurants, we used to do this and then pretend, well, we had longer pieces of salmon that we'd make it into a bikini. Sort of cool looking, don't you think? sometimes I'll just put some beautiful olive oil and a squeeze of lemon on salmon and throw it into a 400 degree oven, which is how I'm gonna cook it today, and just roast it off that way without any topping. But the topping makes it seem special. I mean, to the point where I think you could even do this for a dinner party and people would be fooled. Be like, wow, what a brilliant idea, that's delicious. Okay, so there they go, there's the lineup. We're just gonna put a little bit of glue on top of each one. If we didn't put the glue on top, the crumbs would not stick, so you have to glue it. You could also do this as one whole piece, but then it's harder to cut up afterwards. And what's nice about this is, you know, salmon has no connective tissue, so it's very tender all the way through. So what the crackers do is provide sort of a contrasting, crunchy texture on top of the fish. You could do this with any fish. The general rule when you bake fish at a temperature like 400 degrees is for every inch of thickness, you cook the fish for about 10 minutes. Because it has no connective tissue and it doesn't have a lot of fat, it can dry out really quickly. All right, there's the gang going into the oven. And you see how easy that was? And I did absolutely everything from scratch, including skinning the fish. Okay, we're gonna check in about 10 minutes. Now you wanna check the fish before the allotted time, because the last thing you wanna do is overcook it. Here we go. Let me just close the oven and we'll have a look-see. What you do is you stick a knife right through it. It's not like steak, all the juices are not gonna come charging out. You can see I've hit resistance. I'll tell you where I won't hit resistance is down here, the thinner part of the fish. Knife goes right through. What happens is fish, like any protein, unless you cook it in the microwave, cooks from the outside in. So if the knife doesn't go all the way through, it means it's still undercooked or even raw in the center, which is why we need to give it another 2 minutes. Okay, I'm just serving this with something real simple, because the whole point of doing a 5-ingredient meal is to keep it simple, and you won't be disappointed. Okay, and a little bit of rice. Some sugar snap peas. We sprinkled a few sesame seeds on there. You can just dress it up. My feeling is one part of the meal should be prepared and special. Then the other two things that go with it don't have to be so unusual, they just have to be nice. Okay, there you have it. My roasted salmon with mustard cracker topping. I'm not gonna believe that my friend Jean Anderson's oven fried chicken has just 5 ingredients. And it's such an easy dish. You just put it together, throw it in the oven, and while it does its thing in the oven, I'm gonna be making 2 wonderful side dishes also with 5 ingredients or less. So let's get started. First we need garlic. There's a lot of garlic in this. 4 cloves. And we're gonna make garlic butter. This is really sinful. This is a dish for a special occasion. Even though it's not actually fried, which makes it slightly easier to make, it does have a fair amount of fat in it, and you're gonna see in just a second. So let me get my garlic and my butter just melting. Now, we're using 2 sticks. You won't need 2 sticks, so don't have a heart attack right away, but it's just better if you have a little more butter, because then you don't have to stop in the middle of breading and go make some more in case you might run out. But you won't use all of that, so don't worry. Here we go with our garlic. There you go, you see it doesn't take too long to get them down to a small mince. All right, into our butter. Okay, so now we get our breadcrumbs ready, and what you do is you just take the crusts off. We've already taken the crusts off of several, and we're looking for about 3 cups of fresh breadcrumbs. Now, of course, you can buy breadcrumbs, but they're dry breadcrumbs, which behave slightly differently in this recipe, and fresh breadcrumbs are so easy to make. You're gonna see right now, you can do it either in a food processor or in a blender, and it just takes no time at all. I mean, why not? That was it. So that's our homemade breadcrumbs. I noticed that my butter is basically melted, so I'm gonna get it in here to cool a bit before we add the chicken to it. So I already had measured out 3 cups of fresh breadcrumbs, and to this I'm going to add 1 cup of Parmesan. First of all, really, you should splurge for the good stuff. And when I say the good stuff, the way you know is because on the label, you can always see part of the word Parmigiano Reggiano. And what that indicates is that this cheese was made in one of the regions in Italy, there are about 4 or 5 of them, where they make the real deal. One very interesting thing is we all now know about microplanes and love them and are using them. They're a great tool for grating cheese. However, here's something interesting. I have 1 cup of grated Parmesan cheese here. This was grated on a microplane. It's 1.5 ounces of Parmesan cheese. If I had grated it using the fine side of a 4-sided grater, this would just be 1/2 cup. So when you grate with a microplane, it comes out much fluffier. You got double the volume. So we've grated this Parmigiano Reggiano using a microplane. And then we add that to our breadcrumbs. We toss it up. And if you want, at this point, you could add some chopped fresh thyme or chopped fresh oregano. My friend Jean Anderson learned this recipe at Ladies Home Journal. And then she adapted it for her cookbook and let me use it for mine. But at the time that I added it to my cookbook, my kids did not like green things in their food. So I left out the fresh herbs, the oregano and the thyme, but you can add any fresh herbs you want. Okay, it's time for the chicken. See, this is crazy. We've got very few ingredients, as I mentioned. Now this gets a little bit messy, but we're just gonna carry on. And when you're working with chicken, make sure you don't cross-contaminate. You want to be careful to wash your hands. So first the chicken goes in the butter. That's why we want to cool it just a little bit so you don't burn yourself while you're coating it. We are using whole chicken on the bone with the skin. It's much more economical to buy it that way. What would be even better is if you bought a 3.5-pounder and cut it up yourself. Sort of fun sometimes getting dirty. One of my first cookbooks was Mud Pies and Other Recipes, and this is actually reminding me a little bit of that. So coat these on all sides with the crumbs. And it seems funny, you know, to leave the skin on, but believe me, this chicken comes out so moist. And it's delicious hot, it's delicious cold, it's delicious at room temperature, it's delicious the next day. I've never met anybody I made it for who didn't totally love it. It's a favorite up at our farmhouse where sometimes we have 24 people and we just make massive amounts of this chicken. Okay, there you go. So then, if you want, you can drizzle some of this butter on top. Or you cannot. I'm gonna drizzle it. Meanwhile, I started, of course, by preheating the oven to 350 degrees. Now, before I do anything else, I need to go hose down, so let me do that. Okay, I always keep a bowl of soapy water in the sink. I go into the soapy water first so I don't have to touch any part of the sink, the handles, or anything like that. And that way there's no cross-contamination. Okay, I'm gonna pop this in the oven. These guys are big. Normally they take about 50 minutes, but these might take a little longer. And we'll just check them for doneness in a bit. Now I'm gonna move on to my greens, which is our first side dish. And I'm working with mustard greens today. You can do this recipe. These are gonna be braised southern greens. You could do it with chard, Swiss chard, or with kale. They're all delicious, but I love the peppery taste of mustard greens. And this part of the mustard green is rather tough. So the way to get it off the stem is I just pull down and get the green off. There we go. And leave the stem behind. Now, actually, this guy. Then what you'd need to do is just chop this up briefly and soak it in water. You wash it like you would wash lettuce. So you fill a big bowl with cold water. You dump your, I've already washed these, you dump your mustard greens or whatever greens in there and let them float. And then the sand goes to the bottom, the greens go to the top. You lift them out, you change the water. You keep doing it until there's no more sand in the bottom. And I just chop these up a tiny bit. There we go. Now in here I have, let me just get it going. A quart of chicken broth. Oops, there we go. A quart of chicken broth. And to this we are gonna add, you need to bring it up to a boil. I had it at a boil a minute ago, so we'll be fine in just a second. I'm gonna add my greens right in, and we're gonna wilt them, stir them for about 3 minutes. This is a fun thing to make, besides the fact that it's just so simple. You can make it a day ahead of time. It's even better the next day. And greens, all of the ones I mentioned, are so good for you. Let me just get them down a bit. All right, so while those continue to wilt, let me get my other ingredients here that we're gonna add to this for flavoring. We have ham hocks, and if you can get them split, all the better, because then there's more flavor going in there. What you're looking for are smoked ham hocks. Smokiness adds terrific flavor to our greens. So there we go. And then we're gonna add a little red wine vinegar, 2 tablespoons. I love hot pepper. We need about a half a teaspoon. That was a generous half a teaspoon. And then, there we go. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put the lid on, slightly askew, turn it down, and we're gonna braise these greens for about 45 minutes. Now, while that is cooking, I'm just gonna tidy up here and then come back and start my corn, my creamed corn, the other side dish. Wow, that is reduced like crazy. I'm gonna move my braised mustard greens over here. Ooh, that smells so good. Most of the liquid has gone down. So I'm gonna reduce it a little more. Here we go. Wow, that really reduced. And that's what I want, because I want to concentrate that pot liquor in there. So I'm gonna take these ham hocks out. Maybe they'll give us a little bit of meat that we can add back. And at this point, let me taste this, and I'm gonna add a little sugar and salt and pepper. You can't wait till the end. You have to season as you go. Mmm. Wow, that does not need any salt because of the chicken broth. But I'm gonna add a little bit of sugar and some pepper. Even though we already have the red pepper in there, I like black pepper too. Oh, it's amazing how the texture changes. It really becomes soft and yummy. I'm gonna get going with my corn. And while I'm chopping this onion, let me tell you about corn. Corn has starch in it, right? Corn starch. So although cream corn is often made with actual cream, you don't need the cream. You can take advantage of the natural starch in the corn. The crazy thing about corn is its sugar turns to starch almost immediately. I mean, ideally the scenario is to put your sneakers on, to go to the backyard where you happen to be growing corn, grab the corn, run back to the house, husking the corn as you go, throw it into the water the second you get back in there, cook it for 30 seconds and eat it right away. Now, if you can't do that, if you don't happen to have a cornfield in your backyard, bring it home and refrigerate it and cook it as soon as you possibly can. People, for some reason, think that corn does not need to be refrigerated. Yes, it does. That whole process I just told you is accelerated if it's not refrigerated, of that sugar turning to starch. Okay, I just have these extra bits. Okay, in goes my butter. You could use olive oil. Let me get my onion in quickly. And then I'm gonna move on to the cornstarch part of the corn. Okay, you know, we all used to cut the corn like this, but the corn goes all over the place. So a friend of mine explained to me what a brilliant idea it was to do it sideways, because you can see it doesn't go anywhere. And that's sort of a nice idea. And certainly, you don't wanna waste all that stuff that's on there. You wanna scrape that. That's where a lot of the cornstarch is. But we want about 6 cups total of corn for this recipe. And I almost had that much done already. So I'm just gonna combine this with the rest. And then we're gonna puree. What we're gonna do is pulverize 2 cups of the 6 cups. Exciting? That was really exciting. I love doing these kind of things. Okay, well, let me hang on here. My onions are pretty softened. I'm just gonna turn them up a bit. Let me get this corn in here and start cooking. And I'm gonna strain this liquid that I just made. You need a medium sieve. And this, the stuff that's gonna be coming through the bottom of this is gonna be the starchy part. Yeah, look at all that liquid. So now, we're gonna add some water. And our corn starch corn. And then I'm gonna chop up some scallions and shred some basil. And you're gonna see how nicely, isn't that beautiful? And it's thickening up already, whoa! Okay, so let me turn that down for half a second and chop my scallions. So. We're gonna use mostly the white part and some of the green part. Now, you could take this corn in so many different directions. Let's say you wanted to do Mexican corn. You could start with garlic and onions and then add a chipotle and adobo, some cumin and oregano. Or let's say you wanted to go the Indian route. You could add ginger and a jalapeno and some garam masala. There we go. Do you believe how creamy that is? Isn't that wild? Get my basil ready. Now the basil you want to add at the very end for a fresh taste and also so it doesn't turn that nasty green. And you know the routine, I'm sure, about how to cut up a big herb like this that has these big leaves. What you do is you line them up like a deck of cards, and then you roll them up like a cigar. You make them a tight, tight little bundle here. And then you just cross-cut, shred them. And the idea with fresh herbs is to only hit them once with a knife. Because if you just whack away at them with a dull knife, they will turn black and wet and nasty. Okay, I'm gonna save that. That's the very last thing I'm gonna do. Let me just see if I can get any meat off of my ham hock down here. I've got a little knife for that. If there's anything worth adding back. Oh yeah, see there's a little bit of meat there. You have to take off the fat. Oh, here we go, here we have a little more here. It's like a little bonanza. Okay, I've got everything ready. I think I've got my southern meal. I've just gotta get my chicken out of the oven. Oh boy, wow. This is so delicious and indestructible. It's very hard not to get it right. All right, let me taste the corn and add, I wanna add a little salt and pepper and finish it with its basil. Oh wow, that looks so good. Let's see what it needs.
Oh absolutely, of course it needs some salt.
I know that looks like a lot. People are always like, ah! But it's kosher salt. Kosher salt is half the volume of table salt. So it looks like it's a lot more than it is, but it's not. Stir in the basil. Oof, last thing, because we want it to be really fresh and wonderful. I just love basil and corn, but you know, I think corn goes with every single herb. Corn is sort of like, tomatoes, corn and basil, corn and tarragon, corn and dill. You can just add any herb to it, just the way you can add any herb to tomatoes. There we go. There's our corn. And now let's set ourselves up with a plate and a wing. Hey, you know, if you're gonna have this, you might as well go for broke. And some of our delicious greens. There we go with that wonderful liquid. Time to eat. I'm gonna go sit down. Okay, so we're gonna round this out with some wonderful southern cream biscuits and a little bit of sweet southern tea. And you've got a meal. You know, I have to say, I'm not a fan of five ingredients. I feel like I'm in a straitjacket. But when they add up as beautifully as these three dishes did, I have to say, I'm a fan of that equation. And you will be too. I'm Sara Moulton. Thanks for joining me. I'll see you next time on Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Mm. Sara's Weeknight Meals continues online. For recipes, helpful tips, messages, and lots more, visit us on the web at sarabolton.com/weeknightmeals.
Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.